to 113. Westbrook had 39 points in the loss. He scored, though, listen to this, guys, 31 of those 39 points after halftime. Okay? So Westbrook was just 1 of 10 from three-point range. Suns snapped the Thunder's seven-game win streak. No timetable for KD's return, but let's talk about one Russell Westbrook, Skip Bayless. Mm-hmm. Be gentle. You want to give him a grade for his performance last night?
Yeah, I will. I'm going to give him a C. I probably should give him a lower grade because when you take 38 shots, you probably deserve D-. But, and by the way, that's one more shot than anyone else has taken all year. And the second most shots taken were by your guy, Kobe Bryant, in regulation. And in a regulation game, he took 37 shots.
See, there's a theme with
this. Yes. But last night, Russell Westbrook regressed. He reverted. He took a step backward. And I watched most of this game, and I watched the end of it when I woke up this morning, because I was fascinated by his duel with little Eric Bledsoe, who's not much more than 6 feet tall. And I thought Bledsoe's line was actually more impressive than Westbrook's. Westbrook did wind up, as you say, with a triple-double. But on efficiency, Bledsoe shot 11 for 16 and also had 13 rebounds to Westbrook's 14 rebounds and 9 assists to Russell's 11. Now, this was an overtime game. But, wow, that was an all-star caliber game by Bledsoe. And yet, the Oklahoma City Thunder should have won this game. If Russell had gotten others a little more involved early when he just kept firing and firing. You want to talk about zero conscience. This man, a lot of times I think he's playing completely in Russell's world. He doesn't know anybody. He doesn't know his teammates are with him because he has gotten much better at seeing and feeling, oh, he's open. I think he could make that shot. So I give him that. And that's a new twist for him. It is. But last night, Enes Kanter got off hot. They should have fed the post more because they could have abused Phoenix inside a lot more than they did. They should have won this game by 10 in regulation, but Russell kept firing, 38 shots, 12 makes. He did have a pretty good fourth quarter, not much of an overtime. But again, this is the game, if you're going to make your MVP case, you have to win that game pretty much single-handedly with help, but you got to put the ball in the right places.
See, I'd actually give him a higher grade than that. I say B just because they lost, but I like that he plays on instinct. And you have to remember, Russell Westbrook has never been in a leadership role. This has always been Kevin Durant's team. I mean, this has always been Kevin Durant's team. He's always the sidekick. He's the younger brother that you got to rein in. He's the younger brother that KD's got to let Russ be Russ, but he's got to kind of manage Russ. Kevin Durant has always been managing Russell Westbrook. So this is now Russell Westbrook saying, okay, I'm in charge. I'm the guy that everybody's looking to. He's finding his way there, but I like that he's not trying to stifle himself. Let it go. I mean, maybe I've just been covering Kobe for too long, and I'm used to that kind of performance.
I think there's absolutely nothing wrong with it,
right? But ultimately, at the end of a game, in a game like this, where you have a team that has a lot of new parts on it, a lot of new pieces that don't all fit together yet, that's the kind of game where a star like Russell Westbrook says, we haven't figured out how to play yet, so I'm just going to go win this one. I'm just going to go take this over and win it. He didn't deliver, but the fact that this was an overtime game, the fact that he had them right there, that shows me that he has it in him. We don't know if Russell Westbrook can really lead his own team because we've never seen him in a starring role. He's always been the co-star, but I like that he brought it. I like that he put it out there. And then what I really liked is after the game, he said, I probably shot too much.
Yeah, but that's why I think he's probably, like you said, becoming the leader of this team.
If you win that game,
comfortable.
If you win that game, fine. You don't need to say that because it speaks for itself. You got that W. But if you lose the game and you shot 38 times, you've got to say that. And he did not let his pride get in the way of saying that. All the guys in that locker room, whether they were standing at his locker when he said it, they read it, and that meant a lot.
In overtime, Russell Westbrook had zero assists. That won't fly.
Okay.
In a game that's so winnable, it's like back and forth.
Okay.
And then it comes down to a last shot. And if we could see this one more time just to see what happened on the last play, this could have tied the game. Westbrook gets away with a push off on Tucker. He just shoved him to the ground.
Yeah.
But then he's got what I thought was a fast lane right to the basket. Markieff Morris is coming. And I thought Russell would just go up and either dunk it or at least get to the foul line. And he decided at the last second to try to extend and go up and under. And he left it short. Again, if we're doing MVP caliber play, you got to make that play. If nothing else, you got to get to the free throw line and make the two free throws, which he's highly capable of making. So it shocked me that he didn't take advantage of a play that he set up with getting away with a shove down push off. Oh, and again, that's the play. You got to make that.
Okay, so he's having an MVP caliber month. I will be there. I may be getting caught.
Yeah, I agree with that.
That's all right.
I may be getting caught up in the moment, and tonight again, he can make history. He can meet Oscar Robertson, obviously, as the players that have such a great month. But I still feel as if he's making a strong case, and he's coming because of the fact that you say he's so fearless. He has no conscience.
MVP is always about a narrative, right? We're in the media, and we're the ones who vote on it. We like stories, and we like narratives. So right now, the best narrative going is Russell Westbrook. I mean, if he's able to carry this team with Kevin Durant, who's been out all season with that injury, into the 8th spot, maybe past the Spurs in the 7th spot,
sure.
That's a great
Absolutely
narrative.
Yeah, they will.
Now, LeBron is also working on a great narrative. He's working on a great story.
Yep.
They were 19-20. He sat out. They're 2-10. They had issues with the coach. They haven't figured out what to do with Kevin Love. They had to make some big trades. LeBron is creating a heck of a narrative if the Cavs come all the way back and surge right up to the top of the Eastern Conference.
Okay.
James Harden, again, another great narrative. Dwight Howard has not been there. He's been carrying his team. Steph Curry, that was a nice story in the first half. Where's his narrative? Where's his story?
We just got into the second half.
But the Warriors finally looked beatable. They finally looked like they couldn't necessarily get over the hump in these two big road games that they've lost, and now to the Hawks and to the Cleveland Cavaliers. In those big moments, that's when it's winning time. That's when you make your case. Steph's narrative is fading a little bit unless he goes and recaptures some of that magic. Because Steph was reminding me a lot of Steve Nash. The year that Steve Nash won his MVPs, the way that Steph was playing, he plays right on the edge, right? Right on the edge where he's a car driving 90 miles an hour on the freeway, and everybody's thinking he's going to bounce into something and hit everybody, but he sees it all. I mean, he was playing with that trust and that confidence in himself that Steve Nash used to play with in Phoenix. Mm-hmm. That's how Steph was playing. I didn't see that last night. I mean, the Splash Brothers were 10 for 30 from the floor.
They were.
You got to give Amon Shumpert and J.R. Smith a lot of credit for that.
I got to be objective because I do love Steph.
Yeah.
His last shot of the game, it wasn't quite garbage time, but he shot an air ball from three.
He was like, what am I doing? Yeah, I know.
Just to finish this
make
up.
Make a point.
Listen, I told you, to your Russell Westbrook point, I told you 2 days ago, I am not writing him off for MVP. I'm not sure Kevin Durant is going to come back. And it was 2 days ago, I went down the 26 they have left. And I said, I'm not going to be shocked if they win 24 out of 26. Now, I gave them the one at Phoenix last night, obviously, as one of the 24. But if they continue to rise, which they will, they will, because he's got a lot of nice new toys around him, too, because Sam Presti did a heck of a job just collecting pieces. They already had some good pieces, and Anthony Morrow that they got in the offseason. So they're good enough. With Russell playing at an absurdly high level that I'm not sure I've ever seen anybody play at, to your point, over the last month. If he keeps that up, he's going to make his case, depending on what Steph continues to do, Harden, and the rest. We have a lot of basketball left.
Yeah, the reason why LeBron is going to have a hard time actually even being, I think, winning is because he's got four times against them. He's already won it four times.
Mm-hmm.
I think we like a new narrative.
We get used to greatness, right?
Yeah.
You're great, and then you have to be extra, extra great.
Extra great.
In order to impress us.
Unfortunately.
Now, listen, also, the last 25 years, the MVP has been on a team that won an average of 61 games.
Okay.
So none of these teams...
That would bode well for Steph.
For Steph Curry. Yeah. None of these teams are in position to do that except for the Golden State Warriors and Steph Curry. I actually think this year, when you're voting based on narrative... Because us in the media, we're the ones who vote. We like a good story. Mm. Best narratives right now are LeBron James, James Harden, and Russell Westbrook.
All right.
So we'll see which story pans out. But Steph Curry, that game right there with everybody watching on TNT last night, didn't have that kind of game.
He didn't bring it when he should have. You're absolutely right. Ramona Shelburne, sometimes we call her Roro. Thank you for being here.
You got it.
We'll have more First Take after the break.